Hello students, first of all I hope all of you are staying home and staying safe. Today in continuation of the topic biochemical basis of cancer and carcinogenesis, I shall be talking about tumor markers and cancer therapies. The learning objectives for today's lecture are that you should be able to define biochemical tumor markers, enumerate different biochemical tumor markers with associated cancer, describe applications of tumor markers with respect to detection, diagnosis, monitoring, and staging of cancer. You should be able to explain oncofetal proteins with suitable examples. You should be able to describe the enzymes used as tumor markers, and you should be able to explain the biochemical basis of various cancer therapies, which include chemotherapy, radiotherapy, hormonal therapy, targeted drug therapy, and immunotherapy. Finally, you should be able to describe the measures of cancer prevention. So, what is tumor marker? Tumor markers are substances produced by either tumor cell or host in response to a tumor. They can be present either in cancer tissue like lymph nodes, bone marrow, or circulating tumor cells in the blood, or they can be released in body fluids like ascitic fluid, pleural fluid, or serum. Tumor markers are used to determine the presence of tumor in body or are used to differentiate a tumor from normal tissue. They can be measured either qualitatively or quantitatively. In biochemistry, we determine the presence of tumor markers in body fluids through mainly quantitative estimations, while qualitative estimations comes more under pathology. Now, what should be the qualities of a tumor marker? An ideal tumor marker should be specific, means that one type of tumor marker should reflect the presence of a specific type of tumor only. Then the ideal tumor marker should be sensitive, means it should be able to detect the presence of even very small tumor to make early detection of cancer. Then the level of tumor marker should correlate well with the severity of tumor. Finally, and more importantly, the marker should be cheap so that most of the population can afford the test. But in reality, an ideal tumor marker does not exist. Means, not all the given qualities are found in a single tumor marker. That's why the battery of tests is used instead of using single tumor marker. Now we will discuss biochemical nature of tumor markers. Tumor markers include a variety of substances. They can be simple molecules like proteins, enzymes, and hormones, or they can be more complex molecules like oncofetal antigens, cell surface antigens, cellular receptors, and oncogenes. First, we will discuss enzymes as tumor marker. Elevated enzyme activity can be used to indicate the presence of various types of cancer. The level of specific enzyme can increase in cancer due to either overexpression of an isoenzyme or due to ectopic production of enzyme. In tumor cell, enzymes are present inside the cell and secreted into the blood due to tumor necrosis or increased permeability of tumor cell membrane. Measurement of enzyme activity is relatively easy. Second one is hormone. Hormones have also been recognized as tumor markers. Hormones are released in circulation due to either overproduction by its original endocrine gland or it is produced ectopically by other non-endocrine tissue, which normally does not secrete it. Third is oncofetal products, which we will discuss in separate slide later. Fourth is carbohydrate antigen. Carbohydrate antigens are antigens present on tumor cell surface or secreted by the tumor cell. They are more specific than the naturally occurring or naturally secreted markers such as hormones and enzymes, because they are expressed by only tumor cells. They are high molecular weight mucins. Next is oncogenes. Oncogenes are normal genes present in cell, but they have potential to cause cancer. They are involved in normal cellular growth. But when these genes are exposed to certain factors, they get mutated or become abnormal. This causes overexpression of these genes to cause cancer. Other tumor markers include cell surface receptors and hormonal metabolites, etc. Applications of tumor markers. Tumor markers have following applications. First is detection. Some tumor markers can be used for screening of asymptomatic persons. Second is diagnosis. Some tumor markers are used to differentiate malignant tumor from benign tumor. Third application is monitoring. Some tumor markers are used to predict the effect of therapy where initial level of marker is compared with the level of that marker after the therapy, and to detect recurrence of tumor, as certain tumor markers disappear after therapy, and if they are again detected during follow-up, it suggests tumor recurrence. Fourth application is classification, means the level of certain tumor markers at the time of cancer detection can help to choose the type of treatment strategy and to predict the cure rate or survival rate of patient. Fifth application is staging, where tumor markers can be used to define extent of disease. And last application is targeted drug therapy, where presence of specific tumor markers on cancer cell can help to target drug or toxin towards specific tumor cell. The most successful use of tumor marker have been the monitoring of response to therapy and the detection of early recurrence. Limitations for the use of tumor markers. Major conclusions that have emerged from various studies of tumor markers are that tumor markers are sometimes elevated in non-malignant conditions also. Not every tumor will cause a rise in the level of its associated marker, especially in the early stages of some cancers. No single marker is useful for all type of cancer. Markers are most often detected in advanced stages of cancer rather than early stages. Here in this table, you can find some examples of biochemical tumor markers along with their associated cancers. Alpha fetoprotein and carcinoembryonic antigens are oncofetal products. CA125 is a carbohydrate antigen. Alkaline phosphatase, prostate-specific antigen, and neuron-specific enolase are examples of enzymes tumor marker. Beta HCG, calcitonin, and vanillin mandelic acids are examples of hormones and their metabolites. Benz-Jones proteins in urine is example of serum protein tumor marker, and estrogen receptor and progesterone receptors are some examples, are the examples of receptor tumor markers. These tumor markers will be discussed in detail in coming slides. Before discussing individual tumor markers in detail, I will explain you what is oncofetal antigen or oncofetal product. So, oncofetal antigens are proteins which are typically present only during fetal development and detectable in sera of fetus. The level of these proteins then decreases or they disappear after birth. In cancer, these proteins reappear. The reproduction of these proteins indicate that certain genes are reactivated in cancer cells. Here in this diagram, you can see one embryonic cell showing the activated gene and the product of that gene, which is called antigen. Second one is normal adult cell, where this gene is repressed and there is no production of antigen. And third one is malignant cell, where in the cancer cell that gene is reactivated. So the antigens reappear in cancer patient and can be detectable in the sera of patient. Now we will discuss some clinically important tumor markers in detail. So the first is alpha fetoprotein. Alpha fetoprotein is a glycoprotein having single polypeptide chain. It is synthesized by fetal yolk sac and liver. It has homology with albumin. The levels of alpha fetoprotein declines in later fetal life as albumin concentrations increases in fetal serum. The normal levels in healthy adults or non-pregnant women is less than 10 microgram per liter. The level of alpha fetoprotein elevates in hepatocellular carcinoma, pregnancy, fetus neural tube defect, hepatitis and cirrhosis. In hepatitis and cirrhosis, 95% patients have alpha fetoprotein levels less than 200 microgram per liter. The alpha fetoprotein levels of over 1000 microgram per liter are indicative of liver cancer, excluding pregnant women. So the alpha fetoprotein is mainly useful for determining survival rate of patient and in monitoring of therapy for liver cancer. Next is carcinoembryonic antigen. It is an oncofetal antigen. It is a cell surface glycoprotein having single polypeptide chain. It is composed of 55% of carbohydrate and 45% of protein moiety. This antigen is found in embryonic tissue and in cancer tissue. The level of carcinoembryonic antigen elevates in 70% of colorectal cancer and 50% cases of gastrointestinal cancer, 45% cases of lung cancer and 40% cases of breast cancer. The normal range of blood level is 3 nanogram per ml. Carcinoembryonic antigen is mainly useful for clinical staging of colon cancer and for prognosis of cancer metastasis. Human chorionic gonadotropin, which is also called HCG. It is a glycoprotein hormone. HCG have two units. One is called alpha unit and second is called beta unit. Alpha unit is not specific for HCG, as it is also present in other hormones like FSH, LH and TSH. During pregnancy, free beta unit along with HCG are secreted by placenta. In men and non-pregnant women, the normal blood level of beta HCG is 5 international unit per liter. Except pregnancy, beta HCG levels are found to be elevated in other conditions like choriocarcinoma and germ cell tumor. Choriocarcinoma is a condition where the cells which should normally form placenta start growing abnormally in uterus to form cancer. While germ cell tumor is where the cells of gonads become cancerous beta hCG levels correlate well with the size of tumor, so is useful to show progression of tumor. CA125. It is a carbohydrate antigen tumor marker. It is a cell surface glycoprotein composed of 76% of protein content and 24% of carbohydrate content. It is an antigen expressed by ovarian tumor cells. The level of CA125 elevates in 70% cases of ovarian cancer in stage 1 and in 90% cases of ovarian cancer in stage 2. The levels of CA125 can also elevate in pancreatic, lung, breast and colorectal tumors. Due to its non-specificity for ovarian cancer, this marker cannot be used to screen asymptomatic population. The level of CA125 correlates well with the tumor size. So, the CA125 is mainly useful for clinical staging of ovarian cancer. Prostate-specific antigen. It is an enzyme tumor marker. It is the most promising organ-specific tumor marker. Biochemically, it is a single-chain glycoprotein. PSA is produced by secretory epithelium of prostate gland. PSA is required for the liquefaction of seminal coagulum in seminal fluid. Normal range of serum PSA is 4 microgram per liter. PSA is found to be elevated in 70% cases of prostate cancer. PSA levels greater than 10 microgram per liter means that the cancer is likely. But the area between 4 to 10 microgram per liter is called gray zone, where 1 out of 4 cases are found to be of prostate cancer. PSA levels more than 50 microgram per liter is suggestive of cancer metastasis. PSA is mainly useful for diagnosis, clinical staging of prostate cancer and monitoring of treatment. Estrogen and progesterone receptors as tumor marker. Estrogen and progesterone receptors are the members of nuclear steroid hormone receptor family. These receptors are present in nucleus of breast and uterine tissues. These receptors are used in breast cancer as indicators for hormonal therapy, which you will learn under hormone therapy section. The tumors with positive estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor have high chances of recovery. As we know that some tumors' growth is hormone dependent, such as breast tumor. Estrogen and progesterone hormone helps breast tumor cells to grow. Use of estrogen analog blocks the receptor, thus stop the tumor growth. Tamoxifen is an estrogen analog which blocks the estrogen receptor and thus transcriptional activity of tumor cells. If a tumor is positive for estrogen receptor, it will respond better to tamoxifen therapy. Tumor negative for estrogen receptors are treated with other therapies like chemotherapy. Progesterone receptor assay is supportive of estrogen receptor assay. Progesterone receptor assay confirms that all the steps of estrogen action pathway are intact in tumor cell. It is observed that tumors negative for progesterone receptors are less likely to respond to estrogen analog therapy. Tumors with positive estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor have 75% response rate to hormone therapy. Now we will discuss biochemical basis of cancer therapies. There are many types of cancer treatment strategies available for cancer. The type of treatment used is depends on type of cancer and how advanced it is. Sometimes combination of treatments are used. Cancer treatment options include chemotherapy, radiotherapy, immunotherapy, hormone therapy, and targeted drug therapy. Now we will discuss various therapies in detail. First, we will discuss chemotherapy. Chemotherapy is a type of cancer treatment that uses powerful drugs to kill cancer cells. It is used to treat widely spread malignancies like leukemias, lymphomas and choriocarcinoma. Because the drug is circulated in bloodstream, so it can reach anywhere in the body. Chemotherapy can be given in the form of injection, drip or tablet. It targets cells that grow and divide quickly. It cannot differentiate cancer cells from normal cells. So it destroys normal dividing cells of body along with the cancer cells, leading to some side effects. Normal dividing cells are present in gastrointestinal tract, hair follicles, gonads, and bloodstream, etc. As I have already mentioned in previous slide, that chemotherapeutic drugs either interfere with cellular functions or reproduction. Here, this slide shows various sites of action of cytotoxic drugs used for chemotherapy. So, the first category of drug is called antimetabolites. Antimetabolites are drugs that affect DNA synthesis by blocking enzymes of nucleotide metabolism. They do it by acting as a substitute to the actual metabolite that would be used in purine or pyrimidine metabolism. Second category of drug is called alkylating agents. Alkylating agents work by adding alkyl group to guanine residue of DNA, which causes cross-linking of DNA strands. Now the DNA has been altered. This alteration in DNA activates DNA repair enzymes. These repair enzymes causes DNA fragmentation in their attempt to replace the alkylated bases. As in cancer cells, the repair mechanism is faulty. So, instead of repairing DNA, they ultimately causes DNA fragmentation and cell death. The third category of drug is called intercalating agents. Intercalation is a process of insertion of any molecule between successive bases of DNA strands. So the intercalating drug settles themselves between DNA strands and causes its deformation. Thus DNA is not able to perform its normal function and cell dies. The last category of drug is called mitotic disruptors, which interfere with various phases of mitosis or cell division. This table enlists some anti-cancer drugs. The first one is methotrexate. It's a folic acid analog which competitively inhibits the enzyme dihydrofolate reductase. Second is 6-mercaptopurine. It's a purine analog and it inhibits the conversion of inosine monophosphate to adenosine monophosphate. Third one is 5-fluorouracil. It's a pyrimidine analog which inhibits thymidylate synthase enzyme. Another one is cyclophosphamide, which causes cross-linking of DNA bases and causes inhibition of DNA strand separation. Another one is actinomycin D, which intercalates with guanine bases of DNA and prevents DNA transcription. The last one is vincristine, which prevents cell division and it inhibits metaphase of mitosis. Next therapy is called radiotherapy. Radiotherapy uses ionizing radiations to treat cancer. Ionizing radiations can be of two types. First is photon radiation, which includes X-ray and gamma rays. And second one is particle radiation, which includes electron and proton particles. Usually, X-ray radiations are commonly used for cancer radiotherapy. Now you must be thinking that why these radiations are called ionizing radiations. These radiations are called ionizing radiations because they have high energy and when they enter in the cells of the tissues, they create ions by removing electrons from atoms or by adding electron or proton to the atoms or molecules present in the cell. Radiotherapy is used to reduce the size of cancer or to stop cancer from recurring after surgery. It is mainly used in the treatment of solid tumors like breast, cervical or prostate tumors. Now we will discuss how photon radiation causes cell damage. There are two main qualities of photon. First, it has high energy, and second, it has high penetration power. When a photon enters into the cell using its high penetration power, it transfers its energy to an electron which is located on the outer shell of any atom. By taking energy from photon, the electron is ejected from the atom and an ion is produced inside the cell. This ionization process can damage DNA in two ways. First is direct damage and second is indirect damage. The excitation of atom and removal of electron is shown by the left side of the diagram, and the ionization process can damage DNA in two ways, direct and indirect damage, which is shown by the diagram given in the right side of the slide. In direct damage, photon causes ionization of DNA only and disrupts its molecular structure. Means the photon directly damages DNA atom and causes its damage. In indirect action, the photon reacts with cellular atoms or molecules, mainly water molecules, to start chain reaction of reactive oxygen species production. This causes productions of various free radicals such as hydroxyl, alkoxyl radicals. As we all know that free radicals have an unpaired electron which is very reactive, and therefore it reacts with DNA molecule and damage its molecular structure. The whole process of direct and indirect damage is shown in the diagram given on the slide. Another type of therapy is immunotherapy. In immunotherapy, the treatment strategy is to help the host's immune system to fight cancer. There are various types of immunotherapies, but we will discuss only two main types, which include use of monoclonal antibodies and T-cell transfer therapy. In first type of immunotherapy, the monoclonal antibodies are either used to tag cancer cells to be attacked by the host immune system, or the antibodies are used to block growth factor receptors present on cancer cell. T cell transfer therapy is more specific and used to treat large B cell lymphomas or acute lymphoblastic leukemia. Biochemical basis of the use of monoclonal antibodies for immunotherapy. In this approach, the various antigens present on cancer cells are first identified. Then a specific antibody is created in the lab, which is designed to bind to specific antigen present on cancer cells. This attachment of antibody to cancer cell helps the host immune system to recognize cancer cell as foreign particle. Then host's immune system more efficiently destroys cancer cells. One example of this type of immunotherapy is the use of drug rituximab to treat B-cell leukemia, where this drug binds to CD20, which is found only on B-cells, and makes the cells more visible to the immune system to kill them. Biochemical basis of T-cell transfer therapy. T-cell transfer therapy is used to boost the natural ability of T-cells to fight cancer. First, the T cells from patient's blood are removed. Then the specific antigen on tumor cell is identified. In the next step, a genomic sequence to produce artificial T cell receptor against tumor cell antigen is inserted in T cells by genetic engineering process. T cells with this new genome are then grown in lab. These cells now have new antigen receptor against cancer cells. Lab-grown T cells are then infused in patient, where they specifically bind to cancer cells and kill them. Hormone therapy for cancer treatment. Hormones are responsible for the growth and activity of normal cells and organs. Certain cancer cells use hormone to grow and develop. Hormone therapy is a cancer treatment that slows or stops the growth of cancer that uses hormones for their growth. Hormones are used to treat breast, ovarian, uterine and prostate cancers. How hormone therapy works. The target of hormone therapy is to stop hormone from acting upon cancer cell, as cancer cells are dependent on hormone for their growth. This target can be achieved by following ways. First is by giving medicines which binds and block the hormone receptor present on cancer cell. One of the example of this approach is the use of tamoxifen to treat breast cancer, as tamoxifen blocks the estrogen receptor present on breast cell. Second is the use of medicines to block the synthesis of specific hormone. Third is the elimination or change of shape of the hormone receptor present on cancer cell, so that the hormone is not able to attach to the cancer cell because of deformation or removal of hormone receptor. And last is the surgical removal of hormone producing gland. Targeted drug therapy. Targeted drug therapy uses drugs as chemotherapy, but it's specific because here the drug is designed to target only cancer cells without affecting normal cells, while the chemotherapy is non-specific as it affects all fast-growing cells including normal cells. Targeted therapy works by targeting the cancer-specific genes, proteins or processes that contributes to cancer growth. Targeted drugs are of two types. First is small molecular drugs and second is monoclonal antibodies. Small molecules as targeted drugs. Here the small molecules are inserted into cancer cell. As the size of drug molecule is very small, they can easily enter into cancer cell. To make them enter into cancer cell, the drug molecules are loaded into a nanoparticle. So after that, a nanoparticle is tagged with a ligand which is specific for cancer cell. Now this nanoparticle binds with specific tumor cell and load the drug molecule inside the tumor cell. After entering into the tumor cell, the drug can either block the processes or signals that helps cancer cells multiply and spread, or they can change the proteins within the cancer cell so the cells die. Monoclonal antibodies as targeted drugs. Monoclonal antibodies can work in three ways. First, monoclonal antibodies can block a specific target receptor on the outside of cancer cell. Second, toxin attached antibodies can bind to target receptor on cancer cell and then can deliver toxin in the cell to kill the cancer cell. Third, that antibody can cause labeling of target cells to be attacked by immune system. Here the antibody binds with tumor cell and make it recognizable by host immune system to kill that cancer cell. Last but not the least is the measures for cancer prevention. Here are some general recommendations for cancer prevention. Be as lean as possible throughout life without being underweight. Get regular physical activity. Eat diet rich with fruits, vegetables, whole grains and dietary fibers. Reduce consumption of saturated fat, refined sugars and fast food. Limit consumption of alcohol. Avoid tobacco in all its forms, including passive smoking. Protect yourself from ultraviolet radiation in sunlight. Get vaccinated for hepatitis B and human papilloma virus, as these infections can contribute to cancer. Regular self-examination and screening should also be done for early detection of cancer. Thank you so much. I hope you all liked the presentation.